McCarthy, because you know they haven't been to the point to where they've been running the ball 60-65% of the time since Dak's first year. To stick with that, philosophy, I don't think they can. I think they're gonna win some games, but ultimately aren't going anywhere. That doomsday defense couldn't stop a nosebleed last night. It's cause for concern, just because I think the gap between Dallas and Philly is bigger than I thought.
I told you that too.
Yeah, a lot of people didn't realize, but Philadelphia's All-Pro right tackle didn't play the whole second half. I told you that it was going to be an issue getting pressure, because Lane Johnson, I don't think he's given up a quarterback hit in like a season and a half.
That third quarter though, they got to the quarterback. They affected him.
Lane Johnson was in the locker room.
I know. This is the thing. The Cal, number one, Cooper Rush surprised me. Once that got hurt, I was the first Cowboy season over. So for him to go 4-1, to have people across the country saying, is it a quarterback controversy? That's kudos to him. He got to get patted on the back for that, because
I mean, but that's just bliss ignorance.
100% it was ignorance. But the fact that he was playing well enough to even make this a topic. So congratulations to Cooper. But now it's going to come to an end, and it should.
What I can say is, though, remember I challenged Gannon. I didn't challenge Gannon, but I challenged defensive coordinators. When you have a backup quarterback, call the game the same. They didn't come out and just play single high and give them easy.
Makes it too easy.
They mixed coverages. They schemed.
I felt like the Cowboys, if Dak was playing, I believe they were down 20-3 at halftime. Was that correct? 20-3, I believe so. If Dak's playing, they come out in the third quarter, second half. They probably airing it out. No pun intended.
Yeah, but that's not their style of football. And that's what's gotten them into the problem.
The fact that they honed in and locked in on the run game, I don't know if they do that with Dak. If Dak is a quarterback, they come out throwing it. And so Tony Pollard, Ezekiel Elliott, that offensive line open holes. I was like, man, you know they running the ball. The Philly, like, stopped the run. The Cowboys made it a game in the second half.
If Sirianni in the third quarter declines the penalty and makes it 3rd and 9, that's a 4-point swing right there. Instead, they make it 2nd and 14, they gain 11 or 12, then it's 3rd and 2, 3rd and 3. When we texted each other, like, this is stupid.
It wasn't the best of calls, but you're trying to back them up. The defense had been playing well.
What are you trying to back them up for? The 25 and the 30 and the field goal is no difference.
Very true. But the Eagles, when you look at the Eagles, are you a believer in what I said at the start of the season?
Super Bowl? I don't know, because when you get in the playoffs, it's not basketball. You have one off night.
You don't believe their offense will translate into January playoff football?
I mean, I think definitely the front runner right now. The trade deadline, you know, last year the Rams got Von Miller at the trade deadline. I think at the trade deadline, whoever gets that change of player.
Hey, Nick Sirianni, though, he was out there coaching like we playing Madden football, though. Bring A.J. Brown in motion, sitting there and sliding back out. He ran that play twice within 10 or 12 plays of each other. And I'm like, it's the same setup, same formation, same motion, same results.
I think the issue that some of these teams in the NFL is having is when you play against the Eagles, when you play against the Packers, when you play against
the who?
Hold on, let me just say, when you play against the Eagles, it's a totally different style. You got 3 days to prepare for all scheme runs, all scheme passes. When you play against the Chiefs, the Broncos, the Rams, the Vikings, the 49ers, all of those are West Coast style offenses. I think when you play against the Eagles, you're going to get a lot of concepts and a lot of scheme runs that are schemed
week in and
week out. You
have to be fundamentally sound and sounds real clean. Just do your job and we'll be good.
It's like, I don't know, in your time, did you play against a defense that it was like, we play against Pittsburgh, the fire zone is unpredictable, but then when you play against a team that's like a 4-3 cover 3 team, you know, like, okay, I can read it, I see it coming.
Playing against a 4-3 team offensively was a lot easier than playing against a 3-4 team because a 3-4 team, it attacks your protections.
Yeah.
And so who do you designate as the fourth down lineman? If you're playing Pittsburgh right now, that will always be T.J. Watt.
Yeah.
So you're going to designate him as a fourth down lineman. It does not matter.
99 is always down.
Doesn't matter where he lines up at, sub defense, regular defense, it doesn't matter. But then what happens is when they start bringing other guys.
When they bring 2 weeks.
Then now you got a problem because it attacks your protection. We used to have something where the offensive lineman, it didn't matter if you knew I was blocking you. They would line up, get in their stance, and point to who they were blocking. Not so you know I'm blocking you, so everybody else along the line knows, okay, he has that guy, I got this guy. Yeah. So they would just line up and just point. And I don't. Teams don't do much of that anymore, but I thought for us it was effective. Our offensive line in Cincinnati, pretty much the strength of our team. They just didn't get any
because
credit.
Everyone wants to, like, reinvent the wheel of football.
Where do the Cowboys go now? Do they play any differently with Dak or –
No,
should they maintain,
I think they're
going to
come back.
I think
a part of the reason why they play like this, and we just gave them his flowers, but they don't trust Cooper Rush.
True. I agree with that.
That's a part of the reason. And now it's like, if you play that way with Dak, then how is that going to make him feel?
But they're winning.
They're winning. As much as we
they beat some good teams. It's not like they've beaten bad. They beat good teams.
They have, but they got some holes in that defense. There's been some holes in that defense.
Every team, offensively, defensively, has holes. It's just, can you can you expose them?
Once one person, you know this about the league, once one person do something, like, you know, once you see on film, like, damn, they got them on this play.
The Eagles special, though, man. They got two good corners. They have good safeties.
You about to make me throw my shit. Why you flinching? I ain't going to throw nothing at you.
What you mean?
You about to make me throw my thing. I said this when he had us working in the sweatshop that time when we was filming. He had us working in the sweatshop.
Yeah.
When he had us working in the sweatshop, remember I talked about how they had a good front, tall, long corners. Like, even when their corners was out of position, like, even when Bradberry was out of position on that
when
goal line play,
yeah.
He tipped it. Me, I don't make that play. They striking up the band on me. It's da-da-da, da-da-da.
The Eagles, Gardner Johnson coming in. They're my Super Bowl pick to start the season. So as of right now, they're making me look good. So let's go to the Tampa Bay Bucs.
Man.
Tom Brady.
Ooh.
Let me just say this. We both played a long time. I can't recall ever a player, let alone a starting quarterback, because leaders, they lead.
Let me go even further. The face of your franchise.
You lead by example, or you can lead verbally, or you can do both, whichever one it is. All I know is Saturday is a very easy day. Very easy. You come in, you watch Friday's practice, you do a walkthrough.
So he did none of that.
And you have meetings. He did none of that. And that's not a big deal. Because you know the game. If you don't know the game plan by Saturday.
So did he do Saturday meetings? You think at night?
He didn't do any Saturday meetings.
Oh, he flew to the game on Sunday?
He probably got there Saturday night or Sunday morning. I don't know. I'm assuming Saturday night. If he was with New England, does he go to the wedding?
Bill didn't even go to the wedding.
If Tom Brady is a quarterback of the New England Patriots, is he missing Saturday?
No.
No. So he goes to Tampa Bay, and Jordan Palmer, he says this a lot. Behaviors. Tom Brady's behaviors are different. Players don't care that he wasn't there on Saturday until you lose. Until you lose.
I mean,
and then you're on the sideline yelling at me. Like, boy, if you don't get your ass out of here, you wasn't even here yesterday.
Yeah.
That's what they thinking.
But I think that we talked about like that. This not affecting him, but his
behaviors have changed.
The shit, as Coach Rod Marinelli used to say, you can't let the shit creep in.
It's in
now. I think his kids ain't home when he go home. His wife ain't home when he go home. Things ain't going his way in the sanctuary. I mean, he just looks emotionally
drained.
Yeah, he looks like he ain't there.
Like, when your behaviors change and you're a leader of the team, it's hard for you to jump the offensive line ass. Yeah, that you can do it. when you're doing everything the same way they're doing everything, and you're losing. And not only that, they lost to a Steeler team that was struggling. I believe Pittsburgh was a 10-point underdog, and not only do they cover, they win the game.
Bro, that...
Bill Belichick didn't even go. Like, Bill was like, I got something to do, baby. I got to do this meeting, and he didn't even go.
To see the Steelers convert 3rd and 11, 3rd and 12.
On the same drive.
3rd and 13, 3rd and 16. I mean, it just looks like Tom Bowles is in over his head.
Now, last year.
Managing the team.
Last year, after six games, I believe the Bucs, they weren't 5-1. I believe they were 3-3 last year as well.
Who's the coach?
B.A.
What did B.A. do to set the tempo as soon as he got Tom?
They're 3-3 this year. I believe they were 3-3 at best, 4-2 last year. Can they recover from this year?
I think they always got a chance with Tom. They got a different offensive line right now. Losing the center.
So they got a different offensive line.
Different coach.
Different coach.
They lost.
They have a different quarterback as well. He's a different quarterback. His behavior is changed. He's a different guy.
They lost the Hall of Famer in the front seven. They lost a very good player in Jason Pierre. I don't know what the hell.
Dominican Sue, he gone.
I think Dominican Sue is probably going to be a Hall of Famer.
People don't talk about that dude is stout up front. Yeah.
I think that he's probably going to be. JPP is a very good player.
He's still making plays. With the Ravens now.
And then I haven't seen Carlton Davis yet. Is he back?
He back.
The real Carlton Davis? Or what?
Hey, him and Brady in the same boat. Who's who?
Yeah, and then I think they're asking Antoine Winfield Jr. to do a lot. You can't just get off this Brady shit.
That's the thing, though, because we start pointing to Carlton Davis, you point to Antoine Winfield, you point to the defense.
The defense is bad right now.
But Brady...
The defense is bad. Brady had a bad day.
Yeah, but it's not that. You got to be present.
Well, that's why he's getting a divorce.
You must be
present. He clearly got commitment issues.
Okay, so look. You're getting a divorce because of football.
Presence.
And you're still not all in on football.
He did just drop that Brady brand.
You're still not all in.
Hey, he did just drop that Brady brand.
So you're not all in at home. You're not all in football, and it's causing problems in both. At least go all in on one.
Yeah, I know.
At least.
But what's crazy is that nobody talks about, we talked about, other people tarnishing their legacies, and, the great David Pagan. If this would have been somebody else, he would have been like, should he just quit? Should Belichick just retire before he's un-Hall of Famed?
I don't think he's tarnishing his legacy, but you cannot do this on a football team. It doesn't, him not going Saturday did not matter. That's not the reason they lost. It's optics.
Yeah.
It's perception.
Perception is reality in the NFL.
He's not all in. They know it. The team knows it. It is what it is. Now, let's go to this.
No. Where are we going? We're going to go to Lamar Jackson? You want to talk about Lamar? No.
Let's talk about Robbie Anderson. He gets traded this morning to the Cardinals. One. Have you ever done what he did, or have you ever seen a player and a coach get into it?
I mean, as a young player, that's probably something I would have done. As a vet, as he is, it's just not something you do. Obviously, he lost his cool. They were cleaning house anyways in Carolina. I think he's a Matt Rule guy. Matt Rule was his college coach. He had his best. Matt Rule brought him over there, got him paid twice.
2 years, 30 mil.
Before that, he think he got 3 for 30.
Good.
Got him played twice. I think his frustration is showing. But Baker, trash can, Mayfield is bad. Then he has PJ Walker. He's struggling. He's frustrated. I think just as much as
Baker, not that bad.
Baker
bro.
Is bad
situation, man.
Bad situation. So when they lose, the situation bad. When they win, Baker's good.
Nah, he was hurt last year in Cleveland.
Name me one person in the NFL that's played 7 years and is not hurt.
I'm talking about he was banged up. He had to have surgery.
Was he hurt or injured?
He was both.
No, he was hurt.
He was injured because he had surgery, but he was tough.
What about the three coaches that he got fired before then?
I mean, I have no answer for that. I really don't. I think Robbie Anderson, man, is tough. I hate to see stuff like that because
some shit you would have did though.
A little bit. A little bit.
But why, though?
Because you get passionate, man. It matters. Like, defense, you kind of make your own glory. As an offensive player, specifically a receiver, we rely on other people to help us and vice versa. We help them as well. So he has no targets. They're losing. Frustration starts to set in. I don't know what was said, him to the coach to him. But we got to understand, Robbie's a grown man. That coach is a grown man. Yeah, so it can't get too disrespectful.
But the coach didn't go sit on the cooler by himself.
No, that's frustration. We all have been there. At least the majority of receivers, I know. We all have been there.
The first one, okay. The second time he goes back, like, I want some more smoke.
Yeah, and again, we don't know what was said. My advice is this. If you want to play beyond this year, you can't do that. Like, you cannot show your coach up and then be sent to the locker room. Like, if he does not play well in Arizona.
What does he do in Arizona? Like, where's the position?
Hollywood Brown. He looked like he out for the year now. He messed his foot up.
Okay, so now you
DeAndre Hopkins come back. Right. He'll be able to play this Thursday.
Okay. Then you get A.J. Green.
You got A.J. Green.
Where do you play Robbie Anderson?
He's going to play.
Where?
At receiver, somewhere on the outside.
So A.J. can't play on the inside.
Probably D-Hop will go on the inside. But this is the thing. He can run, and he's going to have to be on his best behavior, or this may be his last year in the NFL, because nobody wants the coach who's in his first game as an interim coach. You can't do that. And it's a black head coach. It's a black position coach.
Hold on. No, it's not. That's
no,
not.
What I'm saying is.
Well, if it would have been a white head coach.
Same thing.
Yeah.
Same thing, but it makes it worse because these guys are trying to, if Steve Wilkes can start winning, he can get that job permanently. He don't need other distractions.
Winning what?
Winning games.
Winning the day?
Winning games.
Winning the down?
He can win games.
Man, they're not going to win anything.
You don't want that distraction. This happened with me once when we were playing. I was inactive. We were playing the Chiefs, and I thought the refs was hoeing us on some calls, so I was talking trash to the refs. Like, and I wouldn't let it go. And I'm inactive. We're playing in Kansas City. And Marvin comes up and he grabs me, like, to tell me to stop. And I grab him back, like, nah, bro. Like,
the head coach?
Yeah.
You tripping.
But I wasn't even playing. But people that I play with emotion. And so my thing is this. I don't know how Robbie Anderson is. I don't know him personally. I don't know the coaches involved. When we play football, emotions.
But
we get emotional.
My thing is,
let Robbie Anderson calm down. Let the coach calm down. We can get back together 10 minutes later and talk through our differences. That's what we did with my situation. I've got into it my receiver coach during the game when we calmed down. Like they used to always say, when TJ get mad, just give him 5 to 10 minutes and he'll be that good.
But that was the thing, though. He gave himself 5 to 10 minutes and he went back for some more smoke.
But we don't know what was said.
Well, he should have finished it off.
I don't know.
That's like you get into an argument with your wife, and then y'all go to separate rooms, and then you walk back upstairs, and 5 minutes later, you start going again.
That's what she be doing. I be like, bro, what's your problem? Like, I ain't.
She come back in 5 minutes.
Yeah, I'm like, bro, like, get out of here. Get out of here. Yeah. That's what she be doing, not me. But Robbie Anderson, hopefully he can go to Arizona and play football, because he could be on his way out.
Be all right.
You take this game for granted, man.
Yeah, it goes fast.
It goes fast as fuck. You take it for granted, and then when it's over, and you're like, damn, I wish I could play one more year. And you can't. And so I wish him luck. You got to avoid that. Now, you brought him up.
Yeah, we going to go.
You brought him up.
I gave him his flowers. He's incredible. They built their whole team around him. But as a passer, when he has to be a pure passer, I don't know if it's the scheme. I don't know if it's his ability. He throws a nice ball. He is just an inadequate passer.
Who's he?
Lamar Jackson.
Okay. Let me ask you this. Outside of Mark Andrews, what receivers was he throwing to yesterday?
I don't give a damn.
Look, that's what I'm saying.
Listen.
That's what I'm saying.
He's been the same way when he had receivers. He was the same way when he had Hollywood Brown.
Name a top quarterback right now. Just name one. Anyone.
A top quarterback?
Anyone besides Lamar Jackson. Anyone.
think one of the top quarterbacks in the league right now would be
just name one.
Well, this year's been rough.
Just name one.
That's playing presently?
Yeah, just one.
Looks like David Carr. He's been all right.
Okay, who's his best receiver?
Devontae.
Easy. Okay. Bam, Devontae. Give me another quarterback.
Patrick.
Who's his best receiver?
Travis Kelce.
Easy, just like that.
Yeah, Mark Andrews is better. That's his best player.
So Mark Andrews is his best option on a receiver.
That's the same thing as Travis Kelce.
Now,
right here.
Juju has had more success.
Juju fucking is stopped.
Right. I'm just stop what it. I'm
before you start.
We agree with that.
Before you start, stop.
We agree with that. What I'm saying is, Rashad Bateman is out. He's been out weeks.
Yeah.
And so in the past
is Rashad Bateman's fault that he takes 16-yard sacks?
No. Bad plays happen to everybody.
Yeah.
Bad plays happen to everybody. This is the thing with the Ravens. They got to finish.
Bro, he's an inadequate passer.
He won MVP. I've never seen anybody be an inadequate passer. And you
Michael Vick. Yeah. Slow down. Breathe. You know what they used to say who his best receiver was? Algie Crumpler.
No, it was Michael Jenkins.
And Algie Crumpler.
Like,
he's inadequate.
No.
Yes, he is. Inadequate.
Like, they got to finish.
Oh,
was he inadequate when they're up 28-7 against the Dolphins? Is that his?
No, it was his running. His feet is amazing. I sat on here.
28-7.
Here last week, and I said, I can go find you another Lamar Jackson before I find you another Herbert.
No, you said Patrick Mahomes.
I said Herbert.
You said Patrick Mahomes the first week.
Okay, still, but Lamar Jackson's a hell of a player, but as a passer, he inadequate.
Now. 28-7.
Yes.
Against the Dolphins.
Mm-hmm.
He was adequate for – that's good enough for me.
Bro, let's just let him pass. You're lucky I don't got my phone today. Where my phone at?
20-3 against the Buffalo Bills.
What are you doing in the second half?
Hold up.
It's one half of football.
20-10 yesterday.
20-3 at halftime ain't shit.
Listen, when you
– 20-3 at halftime ain't shit.
Football league. When you're up 14 or more – you should win that game.
Yeah, but when you got a quarterback that drops back with a blindfold on and that throws a damn cannon, a rocket launcher that literally has no aim.
That's what you're saying he's doing?
Bro, he drops back.
Blindfold?
I've seen him throw hitch routes over people's heads.
Bro.
I can go down to Gar High School and see somebody do that.
Bro, this is like the slander is it's not even disrespectful.
I'm going to tell you something. I can see much better than I can hear. So I just put my TV on mute because I don't even want to
hear. So Lamar not a top 10 quarterback in your eyes?
He's a top 10 athlete. He's a
no. I didn't ask
no
you
as
that.
A quarterback. No, I could find 10 people that I would build my franchise above before Lamar Jackson. Right?
You'd get fired.
You put Lamar Jackson on the Raiders, they're gonna be worse than they are.
Oh my, bro, do you hear what you're saying?
Bro, all he do is run around. Nobody say nothing about him running. The great day for God, I'm gonna text the group chat and say, hey, do you think Josh Allen runs too much? He didn't say that shit last night.
Josh Allen got Stephon Diggs and Gabe Davis out there making plays.
He also got his – he never leave home without his handy-dandy feet.
Yeah.
But his arm, too. He don't just drop back like this. Hey, is anyone open?
So that's who?
Bruh, just drop back like this. Hey, I can't see you. No shit. Open your eyes. He's bad as a pastor.
No, he's not.
I've watched him do this 3 years in the playoffs. Why do you think they don't want to pay him?
Because he wants more money than they want to give.
Why do you think they don't want to give him a fully guaranteed contract?
The slander to me makes zero sense.
Why do you think they didn't give him a fully guaranteed contract?
Because the owners don't want to go down that slippery slope of guaranteeing contracts. That's why.
Oh, so you think they all got together and said, hey, don't guarantee Lamar's contract. But we're going to guarantee the guy's contract that got 23 sexual assault cases.
They mad at them owners.
Oh, my God.
They mad at them.
Boy, you got more excuses than a hooker going to jail on feed.
How many guys in the league history of the NFL have you seen with a guaranteed contract?
Not a lot. But, I mean, he should be changing it.
One!
But he should be
changing. One!
He's younger than him.
And he's trying to get a guaranteed contract, and nobody – the owners don't want to go down that rabbit hole of guaranteeing contracts, but that –
Wait a minute. Do you know why?
Hold on.
Do you know why the owners don't want to guarantee contracts? Do you know what's the problem with guaranteeing NFL contracts opposed to NBA contracts?
Listen.
You can't insure an NFL contract like you can an NBA contract because it's a contact sport.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't want to put the money in escrow. But if it's for one player, they can do it.
Very rarely.
They don't want to put the money in escrow.
Very rarely.
Because when you guarantee a contract, you have to put the money. It has to go to the escrow account.
very rarely does a guy get injured in football in its career ending.
Yeah, but it's changing. They don't even, Lloyd's of London doesn't even do loss of value anymore. That's why you see some of these players when they have loss of value plans, like Marquise Lee, they have to fight with these insurance.
Yeah, because it's actually they ripping people off when they do
that. Yeah, insurance is a ripoff.
The fact that you would get loss of value.
Stop using it. The owners don't want you.
They don't.
They don't trust him.
We haven't seen it. We've never seen it in our lifetime until Deshaun Watson.
So Patrick Mahomes' contract is guaranteed.
No, it is not.
It's rolling guarantees.
His contract is not fully guaranteed. It's completely different than what Deshaun Watson signed.
It's rolling guarantees.
David Mulligetta.
But listen, though.
That's a pat on the back.
He did that. But listen, Patrick Mahomes' contract are rolling guarantees. So what rolling guarantees mean, every year
what a rolling guarantee is.
All right. Well, don't make excuses.
But it's not fully guaranteed. Okay. Lamar Jackson can play. Straight up.
I'm not saying that he can't.
When
he
you up 28-7, that should be a W.
So what happens?
When you up 20-3, that should be a W.
If you down 20-3 with Lamar Jackson, what is it?
Not necessarily.
He been eating that Shannon Sharp restaurant, huh? So cooking up them OLs.
I guess people forget playing the Bengals 2 weeks ago.
Stop talking to me about what happened yesterday.
No. How did they play the Bengals 2 weeks ago? Who got him in field goal range to win that game?
Lamar did with his feet.
He got him in field goal range.
I'm not saying that he's not a good player. I'm saying he's a shitty passer.
He's not a shitty passer.
Okay, what kind of passer is he?
Not shitty. Okay. He's above shitty. So you tell me what's above. Like,
he's an average passer. He's a pissy passer.
He's above average passer. Average is not good. He's above average. Now, is he Aaron Rodgers as a passer? No.
He's not even David Carr.
David Carr is underrated. He don't get the credit he deserves.
Okay.
People hate on David Carr. David Carr can play.
Okay, so as a passer, he's a little bit above Tannehill.
Who are you taking as your quarterback, Dak Prescott or Lamar Jackson?
Lamar Jackson.
Oh, okay. Then.
But not just because of a passer, just because what he can do with his feet.
So, your boy.
Deshaun Jackson?
Yeah, how do you know?
Because he told me he was going to sign with the Ravens.
Well, he's visiting.
Oh, I don't know. He told me he was going to visit the Ravens. That ain't going to help. What are you going to do? Just throw it as far as he can and go find it?
This guy here, man. Hey, Lamar, this guy, when you see this.
He's a good player. I just think that he ain't really. Bro, it's a reason why people was asking him to work out as a receiver.
No, because they're idiots. The people that asked him to work out as a receiver.
So they're idiots. Bashotti's an idiot.
Why?
Because he won't sign him.
They offered him a deal. He just doesn't feel it's worth what he's worth.
They can get out of if you keep losing in the first round. Ain't a receiver on this fucking planet saying, man, I want to go play with Lamar Jackson. You see the way he's throwing that thing around?
I agree with certain aspects of what you're saying.
Oh, God. I'll tell you, if that was your quarterback, you'd be pissed.
To a certain degree, you may be correct. But you saying he's shitty.
As a passer.
He's not shitty as a passer.
Okay. Listen, he throws a great ball.
1 to 10 as a passer, what is he? 10 being the best.
A 4.
Come on, bro. Ain't no way, bro. Lamar Jackson. Bro, it's a 7 as a passer, bro.
No, he can throw it. It spins off his hand beautiful.
But how he throws?
If you put Lamar Jackson on the Green Bay Packers right now and told him to run that offense.
Oh, they probably got the same record. What Aaron Rodgers doing with that
if
offense?
You put Lamar Jackson,
what Aaron Rodgers
if you
doing
put
with
Lamar
that
Jackson
offense?
On the campus,
Aaron Rodgers can't do nothing with the offense.
Aaron Rodgers is retired.
I'm just saying, he can't do nothing.
That's the pardon gift that he getting this year for a contract.
He gone.
Yeah, he's done.
He's not.
Bro, the man was talking about he do shrooms. I don't know. No praise to the franchise. No man in their mid-30s that goes on public record and say he do drugs.
Listen.
Do you?
No. I've never done a drug. So when people talk about doing drugs, that's beyond me. We going to get Maxx Crosby here to talk about this. His team. And I just want to ask him, would he mind Lamar being his quarterback, or if he thinks Lamar is shitty, or how does he feel when he got
to
go?
Bro, he's
Lamar
a shitty passer, bro. He feel like I got to chase this motherfucker around because he ain't regular.
Shitty passer, wow.
He is, bro.
We'll be back airing it out. We got Orlando Scandrick, TJ Houshmandzadeh, Fubo, Sports Network. We'll be back with Maxx Crosby.
Fubo.
Lamar. Like, everyone loves to critique his power.
I'm going to ask you that. Hold on.
Ask me that when we start.
We back.
Fubo.
On a break. Y'all miss me, man. We talking about TJ little-ass sweats, man.
And my sweats is perfect. These things is brand new. I had to pull a tag out. They go all the way
down. Them yours or Karen's?
These mine, man. You gonna make me get up and stand up, take my shoes off?
And stop wearing these fucking Team Jordans every week, bro. Retros only.
Man, I got three pairs
of these. I'm sick of these Team Jordans.
I got three pairs of these.
Go ahead, bro.
Three pairs.
Max, thanks for having you.
Wearing Air Force Ones, no more.
Hell yeah, you shouldn't have raised the price on these things, didn't you?
I don't know.
Go to Foot Locker.
Hey, Orlando.
What's good? Exactly. Tell them. Tell them. You don't know about
every
that. They get that, bro. Them is Team Jordan.
That's what I wear. That's what I wear. I ain't wearing no damn. You need Air Force One so you can get to 6 feet.
Oh, here we go.
That's what you need.
That's what you need
so you can get to 6 feet so you can try to look some people out of
eye. Oh, my God.
But welcome into the show. We appreciate you coming on, Maxx Crosby. Probably you don't get the credit you deserve. Let's get into that first off. Do you feel like nationally people respect your game more so than the guys you go against?
Yeah, honestly, it's funny you say that. Like, for me as a player, I've always, like, I was a fourth-round pick. I had one offer coming out of high school. And, like, I've always had to earn my respect. And I feel like that's what's helped me get better and better every single year that I've been in the league. Like, I'm in my fourth year. You know, last year I was an all-pro, and people still, you know, like to doubt, you know what I mean? And that motivates me. So, like, no matter what it is, positive, negative, like, I use that as motivation. So, like, for me, I still, like, I'm my own biggest critic. So I see everything. I see everything from Twitter to what people are talking about. Like, if people don't put me in that conversation, I get pissed. And, like, I use that to get better. And, like, I was talking to Willie McGinnis. Like, he put up his top 10 rushers before the year, and he had me at, like nine.
You like, bro, like, what you watching?
And I just messaged him. I said, listen, Willie, that's disrespectful. I said, save this. And I, like, no matter who it is, I'm always trying to, you know, find motivation in different ways, because no matter what it is, like, when you turn the film on, I believe I'm the best at what I do. And I still have a ton of work to do, and I still have to keep stacking years and stacking days and games. But, like, my motivation every single day is to be the best in my position, and I put it on the back of my phone. I put the number one on every post I do. It's on the back of my phone. I see it every day, because I know people still want to doubt and still don't think I'm that guy. And it's like, all right, y'all think this sounds good, and like all the people that truly like know and know football, they're starting to give me my respect, and I screenshot that too. So it's like I gotta live up to that expectation of the people that believe in me, and all the people that still doubt. It's like, all right, bet. I'm going to show y'all every single day. And it's not just the games. Like, it's practice. It's everything I do. And that's just what gets me going.
Well, I should have started off with this. Congratulations. You had your daughter last Thursday, man. So I want to say congrats. Welcome to fatherhood. It's the best thing that could ever happen. So I should have started off with that. Congratulations. I hope.
Yeah, thank you. We thank
mother
you
and daughter up. Are healthy, and they're doing all right.
Thank you for giving us your time.
Oh, yes. I appreciate it, man. Everyone's healthy. Just happy and healthy. That's all you can ask for.
Exactly.
So, I followed you before, you know, and I thought that when you got Coach Marinelli, because I came from Coach Marinelli, just your style of football, you couldn't have got a better coach that's more detailed and that it's like coach is a man. And I went to your game a few weeks ago, and just watching the way you play, watching with the effort you play, like the little detail things, running to the ball, just like your energy is just like infectious. And, you know, I think that you are really the heartbeat of that Raiders defense. And I don't think you don't give yourself enough credit. And what I would say, and I'll challenge you, Max, as a player and as a former player, bro, nothing else matters besides what you think. Go out there and be the best version of yourself every day. And I know you know all about that cycle of a snap shit and how it plays out. And just keep doing that and just keep stacking the days. And, you know, don't worry about what people say outside of it. Because, you know, as you played, I played with Rich. 90% of the people in the world don't give a fuck about your problems. And the other 10% is happy you got them.
Yeah.
This dude.
No, that's real.
Did
that's
I make
real
that up?
Shit, though.
That ain't my line.
No, that's real shit, though. Because at the end of the day, like you said, like, everybody's got their own way of getting motivated and what pushes them and what they want to do with their career. And, like, for me, like, my, like I said, like, I'm my own biggest critic. And, like, I've had so many great coaches, like Marinelli and Rich Versace. I talk to them every single week. Like, Marinelli calls me after every game still. And, like, my standard is my standard. I don't have to share that with anybody. I know what it's supposed to look like, and I know what it doesn't look like. And, like, every single day, that's what I'm – when it comes to practice and every single rep, like, I truly am trying to win and destroy whoever's in front of me. So, like, like you said, like, people, you know, screw what everybody else says, like, things like that. Like, I used it, like, obviously I don't care. Like, I used to really, like, when I was young, I would really care what people were saying about me. Damn, they don't respect me. Now I just use it as, like, a tool, like, all right, cool. Like, I'm still not doing enough. And that's what it is for me. Like, all right, if they're still down with me, there's more I got to do. So it just pushes me. Like, you see Aaron Donald, there's nobody questioning if Aaron Donald's the best at what he does. Like, you know what I mean? There's a T.J. Watt. Like, nobody's questioning T.J. Watt. So for me, I know I'm only in my fourth year, but, like, I hold myself to such a high standard. I try to push every single day so it's unfair. Like, you can't not mention my name. And, like, I'm a team guy at the end of the day. But you really – if you got a football team, you got 53 guys, if everybody's playing, trying to be the best version of them, like, it's going to make the team better. And that's what I try to show my guys every day. Like, it's not just on the field. It's in the weight room. I'm in there for 2.5 hours when I, you know, I can do the lift in 45 minutes. But I'm always trying to do extra. So I'm bringing my guys up and showing them what it's supposed to look like every single day. And that's what pushes me. But it's dope. I know you're in Dallas with
them. Listen, It ain't no I in team. But if I don't do my job, we gonna fucking suck.
That's 100%.
That's the truth.
Hey, Max, in y'all last game, there was an incident at the end of the game with Davante Adams and the photographer. What do you make of it, and what has been the reaction in the locker room? Like, dude is trying to sue and things of that nature.
It is what it is. Like, in the heat of the moment, I can't live in Devontae's head and know what was going on, but the dude just walked right in front of him. He's trying to get off the field. Like,
I'm doing the same thing.
Bro, we know you're fucking – I'm waiting for you to push me. I could use a good lawsuit.
Yeah. But, like, that's what I'm saying. Like, Devontae's in the heat of it. He doesn't know what's going on. He's just – you know what I mean?
Wait, it happens.
And Devontae's a great dude. So it's not like people are talking about it around the locker room. It is what it is. Like, it's going to be – it's over with. We're not worried about that.
So y'all going to put a little pot together? Put a little pot together to pay the settlement? Are you going to hit him with
the
man?
Shit. He got enough money, huh?
He'll be fine.
Put a little pot together.
Yeah, exactly.
Playing in Oakland, playing in Vegas, what's the difference?
State taxes?
Definitely.
Do you prefer one over the other? Obviously, the stadium is a lot nicer. I played my last year in the Coliseum. But for you, is the fans, the game day experience, is it still the same? What's different and what's similar?
They're two totally different things. Like, Oakland is that experience. I don't think they'll ever be in the NFL ever again. Like, just how raw it was, how ruthless the fans were.
Walking,
like,
up those flight of stairs to get back to the locker room.
Did you play in
the
–
you got to walk a mile to get back to the locker room.
Hold on, did you play in the Oakland – you said your last game was in the Oakland Coliseum or the L.A. Coliseum?
Oakland Coliseum.
I mean, I didn't know. You played so long ago.
That's too weird, bro.
But anyway, yeah, Oakland was incredible. Like, having a year there, I'll always cherish that because it was the last season in Oakland, and, like, the fans – were insane. Like, you cannot wear another jersey walking through that parking lot. You'll literally get jumped. Like, it's not, they don't play around. So just being in that experience, it was incredible. And then Vegas, we still have our fans coming from LA, coming from Oakland. We got our fans, you know, we're building our fan base here. So that place is packed out regardless. So the fans have been incredible. Like, last year, as we started winning more games and we got on our run, like, that whole stadium, like, you could ask guys around the league, like, I heard multiple people say, like, that's the hardest place to play. Like, that shit gets loud, and it's insane. So, yeah, Raider fans are everywhere, and everybody knows that. So, regardless of where we're at, it's always going to be lit.
You guys play the Cardinals. You have a big lead. You play the Chiefs. You have a nice-sized lead. And for some reason, you're losing those games. What do you guys – what's been the message – that we got to get them. We can't keep blowing these leads because you guys are in a division that's tough. So, well, what's the message, and what are you guys doing to try to make sure we can finish?
Yeah, you know, it's simple as that. It's finishing. It's not just playing two, three good quarters of football. Like, because we've showed that we can play great football against other great teams. We did it against the Chiefs. We did it against the Cardinals. We did it against the Chargers. But we're just a little bit off. And, like, it's been like that for the start. But, it like, if you walk in this building, like, you wouldn't think, you know, we're 1-4. Like, the confidence these guys have and, like, what we have in this building, we know we're on the right track to where we need to be. So, it's obviously it's been tough. You know, football, sometimes luck just doesn't go your way. And, like, it's early on and we have a great support. Like, our coaches and everything, like, they're doing a great job of bringing the guys in and continuing to get us better. And you see it. Like, we're one play away from beating the Chiefs in Arrowhead. We're one play away from beating the Chargers. But we got to do a better job of finishing games and just playing 60 minutes. And I definitely think we're going in the right direction. And we, you know, these next few weeks, like we're very confident we can go in there and turn this thing around.
Coming up as a football player, as a defensive end, who was somebody that you wanted to model your game after that you looked at and said, I want to do what he does. I want to play like he plays.
You know, it's funny because I didn't start playing DN until my senior year of high school. So I've watched everybody. Like, I've been a football fan since I was a child. So from offense to defense, like, my favorite player growing up was Megatron. Like, I grew up in Michigan, so Megatron, just the way he dominated the game, he was my favorite. And Ndamukong Suh as well. Like, in his prime, he was insane. So I've been a fan of the game for so long. And then once Marinelli came here, he started showing me old Warren Sapp and Keith Millard and, like, John Randall and, like, so many different throwback guys. Like, I've watched guys from the 70s all the way up to nowadays. And, like, my favorite players are the ones that play the game the right way, play down in and down out. So when you talk about standard Orlando, like, just seeing those guys, like, they played the game at a different level. Warren Sapp would run running backs down 50 yards downfield. He was 300 pounds. Like, nobody's doing that nowadays. So when people, like, when I'm watching the game, and I'll watch the game three times after we play, and then I'll watch the TV copy, and I'll be like, do I stand out in the way I'm running the ball?
Look, like, for them lows, huh?
That takes no talent. Like, that's the shit I care about most because I know how I work on my game. Like, I feel like my game, like, my moves and everything like that, I've taken huge strides every year, and, like, that's great. But on top of it, like, my effort, like, that's something that I can't control. My attitude every day I show up in the building, and, like, I'm bringing juice. I'm talking shit in practice. I'm trying to bury people in practice because that's how it's going to be on game day, and I try to just live that every day. So there's not one specific player, but, like, from a swagger standpoint, like, I love watching, like, Deion Sanders. I got to meet Deion Sanders. My brother was a roommate of his son in college. So, like, being around guys like that, DB-wise, I know you're obviously everyone's a fan of Deion, but, like, I always try to bring something different to the table. Like, I've never wanted to be, like, somebody else. I've always wanted to be, like, a version, of Jared Allen, these guys, Warren Sapp, but, like, my own entity. Like, I don't have to compare nobody. I want to be that guy that's, like, yeah, Maxx Crosby is one of those guys. He was, you look back, you see a Micah Parsons. Like, nobody's like Micah Parsons. I want to be one of those guys, and that's why I work so hard every single day.
Well, look, keep working. We're going to talk about where we're going to go, where you want to go.
One more. Derek Carr.
No, we're not going there.
He's your quarterback.
Oh, shit. See how you do me?
Do you feel he gets his respect across the league?
He's just worried about his fucking self. Now you want to ask him about the other
Derek person. Carr's your quarterback. Everybody makes things about the quarterback. Do you feel he gets the respect that he deserves?
I don't think so. You know, a lot of people have their opinions. But I think Derek, since day one, Derek's been here almost 10 years. And he's always been a bright spot on the team, no matter what's been going on. He's had, like, 6 head coaches. There's always change. But he's been consistent through the whole thing. So I know people, it's easy to point the finger at the quarterback and blame him. But it takes the whole team to win. And I feel like Derek has done a great job. And I've been here 4 years now. And every year he's gotten better and better. So, I got to, no matter, like you said, no matter what anybody else has to say, like, Derek's a super confident dude, and, like, he's a guy you want on your team. You know, I think he does a great job. So, I got DC's back till the end.
As you should, but TJ, we both talked about it before, and we need to take a second to just give you your flowers on, you know, just the commitment that it took to overcome all the odds that you overcome. The fact that last year they talked about how you were still attending classes and doing whatever you got to do to keep yourself on a mental, like keep yourself straight. And, you know, and a lot of it takes, it's huge for it. Like, if TJ doesn't understand this, and not that it's a bad thing, but he's never used a drug in his life. He barely drinks. And what it took for people that were overcoming and battling addictions, bro, like, you're just a huge role model. And, you know, that shit affected my life, you know, coming out of the league and, you know, drinking and exploring with different things. It got tough at times. And I just want to let you know that what you're doing is huge, and it's affected even players that play before you. It's going to affect players that play after you. And just want to give you kudos on that.
Means the world, bro. That's what it's all about. And I appreciate it. Yeah. Like you said, I'm still going to my meetings, still doing my thing. It never stops.
Yeah.
And that's the one thing I can tell to anybody. And you know this, like, it never stops, the everyday process. So it applies to everything in my life now. And I feel like ever since I made that decision, it's applied to my work ethic, my eating habits, to everything. Like, it's one, every single day I'm doing everything I can to be my best version. And I feel like I'm just showing the world and trying to be, you know, a bright light for anybody going through the shit I went through, because I was on the whole opposite end, you know, at one point in my career. And it's scary. So I appreciate you, man. That means the world.
Well, we appreciate you coming on with us, man. Again, congratulations on your newborn. Man, go turn the season around, because I actually had the Raiders doing well this year. So, yeah, you still got time. Go turn it around, man. I wish you guys nothing but the best.
Believe. It's second
still
quarter.
Believe.
It's second
I believe.
Quarter.
I believe. And
it's
again,
the second quarter. You can turn it around.
Amen.
Again, man,
amen.
Congrats, man. Baby and the mother doing healthy. They're fine. Wish you nothing but the best. Go dominate them.
Amen. I appreciate you guys. Thank you.
Appreciate you.
So, now, Max, we appreciate you coming on with us.
Keep going, bro.
For people that don't really understand his story.
Recording stopped.
And what he's been through. Like, you kind of touched on it a little bit. If you're interested, you can kind of look into his story, read into it. It's well documented. Let's get back to football before we close the show. The New York teams.
Bro,
the Jets and the Giants.
The Jets are playing with high energy. Salah is being the Salah that we've seen as the defensive coordinator with the 49ers. He's showing that Woody Johnson did an amazing job at hiring him. Just his, what he's brought to him. He simplified the defense. They've got players in there that fit the scheme. I mean, they made a big decision to move on from Leonard Williams. Correct?
He was a good defensive player.
You got to think, the guys that they had before that, even if you go before that, it was Muhammad Wilkerson. Like, he got his guys in there. So, you know, they're buying into it. And they're playing tough. They're playing to their strengths. The Giants. Dable.
Bruh. That dude, Dable, he's the definition of coaching matters.
Yeah.
That dude is unbelievable as a coach, man.
Well, so he's going to tell me he unbelievable as a coach, but then going to tell me Belichick need to fucking retire.
I didn't say Belichick need to retire.
Or we need to give the credit to – it must have been that dude, that our boss.
I just said that –
Pagan.
Without Brady –
y'all got to look him up.
Without Brady – Belichick is suspect. That's all I said.
But then we get a sample, a little cereal bowl size of Dabo, and now you want to put him in fucking camp.
All I'm saying is that team is 5-1.
Yeah, they are.
Playing great football, believing. That's the head coach. It's pretty much the same players.
Yeah, actually they lost
that
them.
That
they
had last year.
They actually lost them.
And the way they're playing, like, they're competing. They're down in games coming back. Like, they best receivers on paper.
Yeah.
They not even playing.
The way shout out to Saquon Barkley coming back.
He balling.
But the way Dabo is using him, the way he is calling the games for Daniel Jones, he's giving him the best opportunity. And then the scapegoat, man, he ain't really the scapegoat. Martindale.
Hey, Wink Martin beat his old team yesterday in the Ravens.
Well, you do that because you know it. When you play your old team, you know, like, you know, because you didn't sat in these meetings.
Every line
you
call there is.
You sat in these meetings for so long, and you know what things give them problems and what don't. And, you know, just that was impressive. And then Buffalo, they damn good.
We expected that.
They damn good.
We expected it out of Buffalo. We weren't talking upstate. If you had your choice, Jets-Giants, who would you hit your wagon with?
Giants.
You believe in the Giants?
I think the Giants is one bad offensive pass interference. Remember the crossing route before half? That was a swing. Giants is a because they would have had the Cowboys. They went up by 10, and they would have been up more than that. They should be 6-0. I just think that Daniel Jones is going to continue to get better. They're going to continue to get comfortable in that offense. I think the defense is playing well.
It'll be interesting because they didn't pick up the fifth-year option on Daniel Jones.
They're going to pay for it.
And so he's playing good football. He's not playing.
Good quarterback play costs you about $40 million a year.
You pay Lamar $40 million a
year?
Oh. Oh, my. You'll pay Daniel Jones $40 million, but you wouldn't pay Lamar Jackson.
$40 million a year? I mean, I'll pay Lamar $40 million a year, but I ain't giving him four for 160 fully guaranteed.
So you take Daniel Jones over Lamar Jackson?
I just feel like Daniel Jones' arm talent is better than Lamar.
You ain't tapping that much. Lead me to believe you was leading with your head the way you talking today.
Bro, what you talking about? I don't like his arm. I don't like him I only like his feet. And then at his feet, he's at more risk of getting injured. So break it down like this. I'm fine with Josh Allen running because Josh Allen is a big built guy. Lamar Jackson is a thin dude. Like, you know what I'm saying? Just optics. Like, I just don't like, and I don't like the sidearm. I don't like it. You look at Patrick Mahomes. I don't like Daniel Jones like that, but if I don't got nothing else, if I'm sitting there with
you
nothing
else. You just
said
you got to pay to keep him. They going to keep him.
But, I mean, they don't have anything else. I put Huntley in. He came and did the same thing. Pay him about $10 million a year. We still going to lose in the first round.
Did the same thing, huh?
Yeah. Against the Packers. We still going to lose in the first round, right?
Lamar ain't going to lose in the first round.
He always loses in the first round.
Huh?
Huh? My grandma said you can hunt, you can hear.
He ain't winning in the first round? I recall he
has once, but you know what I'm going to tell you. Sometimes this person is out of cooks, and you don't eat it all. And even the trash can get a steak.
You just said even the trash can get a steak.
And even the sun shines on a dog's ass sometimes.
You just said he can't get out the first round. He's been out of the first round.
And then what happened in the next round? Has he been to the championship game?
No. Not many quarterbacks.
So it's the first round.
Not. Huh?
Yeah, wild card.
He beat the Tennessee Titans
in the wild card.
In the first round.
And then, what's his playoff record?
I don't know.
1-4? This ain't fucking baseball.
1-3?
1-3? Oh, yeah. 333 is only good in baseball.
Would you rather get to the playoffs or be watching the playoffs?
I mean, we're going to do both. The way that the team is built, we're going to do both. I can go find another quarterback that can run.
You think you can find somebody that can do what Lamar can do?
I can find somebody that can run. I can find four players that I can get instead of paying $45 million a year.
If Lamar couldn't throw, why don't they just put 8-9 in a box all the time and stop the run if he can't
throw? It's because it's not about it being 8-9 in the box, because it doesn't matter if you have 8 in the box with the quarterback, because you're still outnumbered, because quarterback run makes it even numbers. That's what makes quarterback run so hard. Putting 8 in the box only works when you're giving it to the running back. But now if I got 2 running backs leading and I'm pulling and I'm always removing gaps, I still got 1 more than you. It's a numbers game. You know this, man.
Why won't everybody do that?
What you mean? They try. The teams that
they
do
did. That. That's my point.
They're 3-3. Clearly they're doing something right.
Man, Lamar Jackson, the slant. We done went from New York back to Lamar.
I'm not slandering him. I'm just saying that, TJ, you know this.
You basically, in so many words, said you would take Daniel Jones over Lamar.
I never
You
said
basically
that.
Just said that.
I said I would pay Daniel Jones just because of where, if they continue at this rate.
And then when I said, would you take Daniel Jones over Lamar, you thought about
no,
it.
No, I said,
you thought about it.
I got to think. Now you want to take away my ability to think?
That's nothing to
think
about.
That's why Lamar's struggling. They didn't took away his ability to think. Either run or throw it to this one person. That's another reason why I wouldn't sign up all that money, because his ability to think.
Let me ask you this.
You just got me saying outlandish things.
You saying outlandish things.
I take it back. I take it back. Man. I'm all up top. Lamar Jackson, a hell of a player. as a passer, he's just inadequate.
No, you said
he needs him. No,
he's shitty. That's
he's not. He has some. He can improve. And I think that, like, mechanically, it puts him at a disadvantage. But the same things that make you laugh about him make you cry if you're a defense, because he can make a, he can ad lib. He can get a first down.
Sorry, Lamar. I think you can really play.
Yeah, but you didn't talk about that when he DM'd your daughter.
Shut up. That's going to get edited out. Now, the Tampa Bay Bucks, this guy here, the Tampa Bay Bucks and the Green Bay Packers, many thought they would have a really good season. Brady, Aaron Rodgers, who are you more concerned with? This dude here, bro. Who are you more concerned with? Tom Brady or Aaron Rodgers?
I'm more concerned with Aaron Rodgers just because I think Aaron is just mentally checked out. I think
he's my daughter texting me.
I think he's frustrated with the general manager. I don't think he really wanted to be there. I think ain't nobody in their right mind gonna turn down $100 million guaranteed. I'll play on the moon for $100 million. But, I mean, I think, you know, Tom, they'll be okay. They'll make the playoffs. I think Tom.
Will Green Bay?
I'm not sure. But I think the way Tom is wrapped, he'll hone in, and everything that he does is to prove somebody else wrong. So, unless them tarot cards that Giselle reading is affected him.
Well, man, Tom Brady, get it together. Be a team player. Lamar, you that dude, don't listen to this guy.
Yes.
Maxx Crosby, again, we appreciate you coming
when
on.
When did I ever say he wasn't that dude?
You said he was shitty.
He's inadequate as a passer.
Congrats on your daughter. You said he was shitty.
As a passer, sometimes a girl is shitty the way she look, but then when you get to know her, she's good.
If she's shitty in the way she look, I'm not getting to know
That's
her.
That's shallow.
Well, shallow I am, because I'm not getting to know her. So there we go. Airing it out, we got Orlando Scandrick. CJ Houshmandzadeh, Fubo Sports Network. We'll
appreciate
be back
y'all
next week. Thank you. You said he was shitty.
No, as a pastor and a bad DMer.
Hey, you know.